السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I think we're going to try the salam again. It seems that every time a speaker makes salam, we have to try it again. And in our last event, I said, I make dua to Allah that the one who replies the salam the loudest, that Allah grant them £1 million. You believe it's possible or not? Is it possible or not? It's possible. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, I'm delighted to be here in Cardiff for the first time. MashaAllah, you've got an amazing community. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant you all goodness. Say Ameen. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant you all the best in this world and the next. And may he gather us in the highest part of Jannah. Ameen. Sheikh Rayyan, he read some beautiful verses. The last verse that he ended off on, he recited the verse of Allah where he says, إِنَّ هَذِهِ أُمَّتُكُمْ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً. Indeed, this ummah is one ummah. What brought you here today? There's no blood relation generally between us. You didn't come for any wealth. You came because you are part of the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Right or wrong? Right. And in the same verse, Allah ends off by saying, "Wa ana rabbukum," I am your Lord. So the only thing that brings us here together is the fact that we worship Allah alone. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us true members of the ummah, and may he grant us goodness. Ameen. When you look at the theme of this year's or this season's conference, you find that it's called Power of Worship. Worship is generally translated in the Arabic language as ibadah. I'm going to ask a question, and whoever's got an answer, you can shout at me. When you hear the word ibadah or worship, give me an example. What comes to your mind? Anybody's got an example of ibadah? Salah. I heard a loud answer. Salah. What else is ibadah? Fasting. What else is ibadah? Zakah. What I want you to notice is these acts of worship that you mentioned, yes, they are ibadah. Notice how it's all about doing a good deed. You are doing something, performing your salah, giving your zakah, fasting for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the same breath, ibadah also includes staying away from the prohibitions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this ibadah, there's things you have to do, and there's things you have to abstain from. You've got to stay away from them. And this is ibadah. And when you ponder over the stories of the Anbiya alayhim as-salatu wassalam, you'll find that there were acts of worship that they carried out, and there were also prohibitions that they stayed away from. A lot of us think that ibadah is only to do good deeds, forgetting that it's also to stay away from evil. So that's point number one. Bear that in mind, because I'm going to go through a story of one of the prophets of Allah. Secondly, when it comes to ibadah, it's carried out, or worship is generally performed in public, especially your compulsory acts of worship. So for example, people, if they had to see you now, they know you're a Muslim. When you perform your compulsory salawat, people generally see you, especially for the men. For example, you perform your salah in the masjid. However, more powerful after having fulfilled your compulsory acts of worship is to perform your ibadah in secret, in private. And when you ponder over the verses that Sheikh Rayyan read, you'll find Allah Jalla wa Ala makes mention of many anbiya, many prophets of Allah. And he makes mention of some of their acts of worship. And you find the theme is They were either doing good deeds or staying away from that which was prohibited, and a lot of them, it was carried out in private. That's why Yusuf alayhi salam, we all know the story of Yusuf alayhi salam, right or wrong? It's known as the best story in the Quran. There's a lot of lessons we can take. I want to pick up the story where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention that Yusuf alayhi salam has been sold as a slave. He eventually comes to the house of the Aziz. The Aziz, who is the governor or the leader of Egypt at the time, he tells his wife, honor Yusuf alayhi salam. Look after him. He's a good person. Eventually, the wife of the Aziz decides to seduce Yusuf alayhi salam. Allah makes mention of it. وَرَاوَدَتْهُ الَّتِي هُوَ فِي بَيْتِهَا عَنْ نَفْسِهِ وَغَلَّقَتِ الْأَبْوَابِ وَقَالَتْ هَيْتَ لَكَ. She seduced him, she locked the doors, and she said, come close to me. What does Yusuf alayhi salam do? He engages in an act of worship. What's the act of worship? He's staying away, abstaining from zina. And notice how he was in private. He was alone. If he had to commit the sin, nobody was going to know. That's why she locked the doors. But Allah Jalla wa'ala tells you that immediately he realizes he's not alone. قَالَ مَعَاذَ اللَّهِ. I seek Allah's protection. إِنَّهُ رَبِّي أَحْسَنَ مَثْوَايِ. My master has done good to me. Why should I cheat? Why should I go behind his back? Why should I backstab him? A lot of the times we don't realize, especially in the modern world we live in today, with fitna being so accessible, some of the best ibadah that you can carry out is in private. Either doing good deeds or abstaining from that which is evil. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention of this in various verses in the Quran. For example, Allah jalla wa ala makes mention of Yunus alayhi salam. We all know Yunus alayhi salam, he left his people before Allah told him to leave. Eventually he swallowed by the whale or the fish. When he calls out to Allah, Allah makes specific mention or special mention, فَنَادَى فِي الظُّلُمَاتِ. He calls out in the darknesses. He was alone. There was nobody. Remember, when you carry out acts of worship in secret, they are closer to sincerity. There is, بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ, more power. You benefit from your ibadah. You benefit from your acts of worship. Again, Yusuf alayhi salam, when he was eventually imprisoned, he goes into the prison and there's two people who come to him. They have dreams. They want the interpretation. He's alone. He could have refused to interpret the dreams. However, he helps them. And what do they say in return? They say, "Inna naraka min al-muhsinin." We see you, O Yusuf, as a good doer. Whether you're alone, you're with a small group of people, or you're in public, a lot of the times the problem that we face is we try to maintain an amazing image in the public eye, forgetting that when we in private, our ibadah is as important, and that ibadah carried out in private is generally higher and better. I want you to ponder over a hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, on the day of judgment, there will be seven groups of people. سَبْعَةٌ يُظِلُّهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي ظِلِّهِ يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّهُ. Allah will shade them on the day of judgment where there will be no shade except His. Anybody know who these seven groups are? If you don't know, you can Google, because we're going to go through them one by one. Anybody knows the hadith that I'm speaking about? Anybody knows? MashaAllah, there's a few. If you don't know, look it up. And inshallah, we're going to go through them one by one, because there's a lesson, there's a theme I want you to be able to extract when we get to the end. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam starts off by saying, Imamun Adilun, This is the first category of people who will be shaded on the day of judgment, the day where there is no shade. Imagine when a person is in control, they're in charge. The only thing that keeps them just and prevents them from oppressing others is having that fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right or wrong? Right or wrong? What stops them? Nothing else. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is telling you, Imamun Adilun. Who's the next category of people? Anybody knows? وَشَابٌ نَشَأَ فِي طَاعَةِ اللَّهِ أو فِي عِبَادَةِ اللَّهِ. The second is a youngster or a youth, young girl, young boy, who is nurtured. They grew up in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Again, ponder and reflect. What are the similarities between the first and the second? The second person, the youngsters, they generally have a lot of energy. They have power. They are able to do as they please. But this young man or this young woman chose to remain obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What did that require? It required the person to be disciplined. It required the person to obey Allah in public as well as when they were alone. Right or wrong? Right or wrong? وَشَابٌ نَشَأَ فِي عِبَادَةِ اللَّهِ. The third category, who knows? Louder? A man who loves the masjid. وَرَجُلٌ قَلْبُهُ مُعَلَّقٌ بِالْمَسَاجِدِ. A man who, the literal wording of the hadith is, his heart is hung up in the masjid. He's attached to the masjid. What does this show you? When there were people in the masjid, he would go. And also, when there wasn't anybody there, when he was alone, his thoughts were still occupied. He was still attached to that masjid. Notice how all of them, all the three we've gone through so far, they required some sort of attachment to Allah. In public, as well as in private. It required sincerity. And look at how they benefit. Not only is there benefit for them in this world, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam is telling you that there's a great reward for them in the akhirah. Who knows the fourth category? In order, that's almost the last. In fact, the last one. وَرَجُلَانِ تَحَابَّ فِي اللَّهِ. Two people who loved each other for the sake of Allah only. اجْتَمَعَ عَلَيْهِ وَتَفَرَّقَ عَلَيْهِ. They gathered on that, and whenever they departed, it was only for the sake of Allah. You know, so many times people befriend you when your rank or your popularity or your wealth increases. And Allah is telling you, or the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam is saying, that those who have true friendship are the ones who love for the sake of Allah. That's why in the Quran, Allah says, الْأَخِلَّاءُ يَوْمَئِذٍ بَعْضُهُمْ لِبَعْضٍ عَدُوٌ إِلَّا الْمُتَّقِينَ. You find people who are close, bosom buddies. On the day of judgment, they will all be enemies to one another. Why? Because that friendship was not in the obedience of Allah. It wasn't for the sake of Allah. And this, my beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, is one of the easiest acts of worship a person can carry out, especially in today's time. You love a fellow Muslim only for the sake of Allah. Imagine the reward the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam is telling you about. He's saying that these people will be shaded on the day of judgment. Who knows the next category? Sorry? You need to speak louder. Number five, وَرَجُلٌ دَعَتْهُ امْرَأَةً ذَاتُ مَنْصِبٍ وَجَمَالٍ فَقَالَ إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهِ. A man, a youngster, who is called to commit a sin by a woman who is beautiful or a woman who is of nobility and lineage in private, and he says, I fear Allah. And it includes a man or a woman, wallahu a'lam. So look at how this person was able to disobey Allah in private, but they chose to fear Allah. Who knows the next category? MashaAllah. وَرَجُلٌ تَصَدَّقَ بِصَدَقَةٍ. A person who gives charity. وَرَجُلٌ تَصَدَّقَ بِصَدَقَةٍ فَأَخْفَاهَا. But he keeps it hidden. He hides it such that the left hand doesn't know what the right hand spent. Notice how this act of worship again is carried out in secret, in private. And there's a question I'd like to ask you. Is it always better for a person to spend in secret, or are there times where it's okay or maybe better to give your sadaqah in public where the people know? Both. Secret. There's detail when it comes to the answer. If nobody got an answer, I think we need to give a prize. The brothers at the back. MashaAllah. So roughly what the brother mentioned. The default is it's always better to give your charity in secret. However, at times, it may be better to make your charity public if it's hoped that those around you will also follow your example. And we get this from the Quran. Allah Jalla wa Ala says, إِن تُبْدُوا الصَّدَقَاتِ فَنِعِمَّاهِ. If you had to give your charity in public, people know about it. At times, it's still a good charity. It's not haram. وَإِن تُخْفُوهَا وَتُؤْتُوهَا الْفُقَرَاءَ فَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. If you had to hide it, okay, and you had to give the poor people, without anybody else knowing, it's better. So that's the default ruling. But as I mentioned, at times, if it's hoped that in a large group of people, by them seeing you doing that good deed, it's hoped that they will learn, they will follow. At that moment, inshallah, it's hoped that you will be rewarded and it may be better. Who knows the last category of people mentioned in this hadith? Somebody mentioned it here and I said it's the last one. وَرَجُلٌ ذَكَرَ اللَّهَ خَالِيًا فَفَاضَتْ عَيْنَاهُ. A person who remembered Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and noticed the word in private, when he was alone, when she was alone, and he teared, he cried. What did he cry for? Out of the fear of Allah, knowing that he's sinned, he's oppressed himself. Notice how all these categories of people that we went through, they carried out an act of worship. Either it was to do something or to abstain from something, and all of them were sincere. All of them were sincere. They did it solely for the sake of Allah. They were alone. Whilst they were alone, they were able to transgress. So my beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, the message I want to give you today is, we all know ibadah and worship. It's powerful. Make sure your compulsory acts of worship are in order. And over and above that, try to have good deeds which you carry out in secret, because you will find that these good deeds are powerful. A person may say, how do I become somebody who can obey Allah in private? I think it's one of the most difficult things to do in today's time, right or wrong, with technology, with the amount of fitna that's easily accessible, especially for the youngsters. There's a lot you can do, but I'll give you what I believe to be the most important. Make sure you have a good heart. You have a clean heart. Your heart inclines towards goodness. How many times you find a person who, they stuck with a sin. They stuck with a sin. It could be anything. I don't want to name them. And they say, we make tawbah and we carry on falling into the sin. And we make tawbah and we carry on falling into the sin. Ask yourself, when you were making tawbah, were you only paying lip service, Some people are saying, Astaghfirullah, Astaghfirullah. But the heart is still attached to the sin. You have to start off from the inside. You've got to rid your heart of this attachment of the sin. Look at what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the best generation. Who were the best generation? The Sahaba radiallahu anhum. So we all know the best people to have ever lived are the prophets of Allah. After that, the best are the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You'll find that when Allah describes them in the Quran, in many different verses, He talks about the purity of the heart. He talks about the purity of the heart. So for example, in Surah Al-Hujurat, Allah Jalla wa'ala says, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, the best generation, they obey the commandments of Allah and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam because they possess certain traits. What are these traits? Notice how it's all in the heart. وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ حَبَّبَ إِلَيْكُمُ الْإِيمَانِ Number one, Allah made them love iman. So the good deeds that you're supposed to carry out, don't only do them physically or apparently. Make sure it's coming from within. Allah is telling you, this group of people, He made them love iman. Not only that, وَزَيَّنَهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ He beautified this iman in the hearts, in their hearts. And then He says, وَكَرَّهَ إِلَيْكُمُ الْكُفْرَ وَالْفُسُوقَ وَالْعِصْيَانَ As for the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, He made them dislike all that which displeases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How many of us want to get rid of the bad habits we have, the sins we are addicted to? However, the heart is still attached. So start off by purifying the heart. Allah Jalla wa Ala tells the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya ayyuhan nabi, O Messenger of Allah, tell those who've been captured, as you know, in one of the battles, some of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum who were hiding their Islam, their Iman, they were captured and some wealth was taken away from them. So Allah says, O Messenger of Allah, tell them, إِن يَعْلَمِ اللَّهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ خَيْرًا يُؤْتِكُمْ خَيْرًا مِمَّا أُخِذَ مِنْكُمْ Don't worry, some wealth has been taken away from you. But if Allah knows that there's goodness in your heart, He will give you that which is even better than what was taken away from you. So start off by purifying the heart. Start off by trying to carry out an act of worship in secret, which is only between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I know I've got one more minute left. I hope we've benefited from what's been said. As I mentioned, try your best to have those secret acts of worship that are only between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nobody else knows about them because they are closer to sincerity. Ponder over the stories of the Anbiya alayhim salatu wassalam. You'll find that they also had their secret acts of worship. Surah Al-Muzzammil is known as the Surah of Qiyamul Layl, the Surah where the voluntary night prayer is mentioned. Imagine after the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam gets revelation, immediately Allah tells him, قُمِ اللَّيْلَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا Stand in the night prayer. Whilst you're alone, nobody needs to know. And this was the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. At the end of the surah, Allah says, O Messenger of Allah, we know that you have this voluntary prayer at night. And we know that there's a group of people who are with you who also perform this voluntary night prayer. The word ibadah, a lot of us think, is only limited to salah and zakah and fasting. However, when you look deeper, you'll find that ibadah is everything that pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It could be a good thought, it could be good speech, or a good action. As long as it pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the correct intention, it's considered ibadah. When you look through the stories of the Quran, you find that Allah jalla wa ala makes mention of different ibadat, different acts of worship. And He makes mention of some of the pious people who came before, especially the Anbiya alayhim salatu wassalam. Today I want to pick up the story of Musa alayhi salam so that we're able to derive a lesson, to show us the power of ibadah, the power of worship. Take a moment to go back. We all know the story. Musa alayhi salam is faced with Fir'aun. Fir'aun, the Pharaoh, has gathered all the magicians and there's a face-off. Now take a moment. The whole community, the whole country, the whole city have gathered to watch a spectacle. What's going to happen? What's the event? Musa alayhi salam and his brother Harun against all the magicians, the best of the best. Fir'aun has gathered them in front of who? The person who claimed to be Allah. And the stakes are high. The magicians, before commencing, they tell Fir'aun, if we beat Musa and his brother, if we are victorious, you are going to give us some sort of reward. Fir'aun tells them, don't worry. Not only will I reward you, but you will be with, or you will be from amongst my close circle. Eventually, Musa alayhi salam tells them to throw whatever magic they came with. Allah Jalla wa Ala makes mention that they threw their ropes, and it was made, or the people around imagined these ropes to be serpents. It was great magic. And Allah Jalla wa Ala tells Musa alayhi salam, don't fear. Throw your staff. Musa alayhi salam throws the staff, and because it's from Allah, it's a miracle, one of the miracles of Musa alayhi salam. His staff eats up all the magic they came with. Now imagine, it's a spectacle, it's an event. Musa alayhi salam, in our terms, you know, when you've got a strong team and a weak team, and you say the underdogs, they are the ones who were victorious. In this case, nobody expected Musa alayhi salam and his brother Harun to be victorious. But by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they were victorious. How do you think the Pharaoh felt? How do you think Fir'aun and his people felt? They were upset. They were furious. Allah Jalla wa Ala tells Musa alayhi salam, he says, leave with your people because Fir'aun and his army are pursuing you. They're going to pursue you and they're going to come after you because they've lost. And it's been a long time full of oppression. So Musa alayhi salam is told to leave. Eventually he goes with his people. He's running, and the whole of Banu Israel are going with Musa alayhi salam. Behind them is who? Fir'aun and his army and his people. They reach a point where the water or the sea is in front of them. The sea is in front of them. The people of Musa alayhi salam, they say, قَالَ أَصْحَابُ مُوسَى إِنَّا لَمُدْرَكُونَ. They tell Musa, after all this, you've brought us to this position, we're surely going to be caught because the army is behind us and the water is in front of us. We've got no chance. What does Musa alayhi salam say? Anybody knows the verse after that? What does Musa alayhi salam say? قَالَ كَلَّا. Musa alayhi salam says, never. Inna ma'ya rabbi sayahdeen. My Lord is with me and he will guide me. Look at the power of ibadah, the power of conviction that Musa alayhi salam had. Now the question is, how many of us face difficulty and hardship in our life? And when we need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we feel that our dua is not answered. Our ibadat, we feel at times that there's no benefit. We're not seeing the fruits of it. What I want you to invite, or what I want to invite you towards and study is, look at the life of Musa alayhi salam before this. Before the seas parted way by the permission of Allah in order to save Musa alayhi salam and Banu Israel. What you'll notice, we'll go over some of the verses. Even before prophethood, Musa alayhi salam had refined himself as a person. So we find when he was still very young, he came from a noble family, a noble household. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention of his mother, makes mention of his sister. And Allah tells the mother of Musa alayhi salam, don't worry, you bring up Musa alayhi salam for a period of time. And then you put him into the river and we will return him to you. Eventually he grows up in the house or the palace of Fir'aun. As he's a youngster and he's grown up, Allah says, وَلَمَّا بَلَغَ أَشُدَّهُ وَاسْتَوَى آتَيْنَاهُ حُكْمًا وَعِلْمًا. When he grew up, he was strong, mature. We gave him understanding and we gave him knowledge. He wasn't yet a prophet. He was not yet given nubuwa. Eventually, one day, he enters into the city. When he enters into the city, he finds these two people who are arguing, two people who are quarreling. One from his clan or his tribe, Banu Israel, and one from the opposition, the people of Fir'aun. So the person from his tribe or his clan says, help me. He calls out for some help. So Musa alayhi salam tries to help him. And Allah says, فَوَكَزَهُ مُوسَى فَقَضَى عَلَيْهِ. The enemy, Musa alayhi salam, struck him. He didn't intend to kill him, but because the blow was so strong, this person died. What does Musa alayhi salam do immediately after that? He's not yet a Nabi of Allah. He hasn't yet been given prophethood. But look at how he understands that this is from shaytan. Immediately he says, قَالَ هَذَا مِنْ عَمَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ. He knows that this is something wrong. This is not befitting. And he asks Allah to forgive him. He says, قَالَ رَبِّ إِنِّي ظَلَمْتُ نَفْسِي فَغْفِرْ لِي فَغَفَرَ لَهُ. Oh Allah, I've wronged myself. I've oppressed myself. Forgive me. What's the message? We saw how the sea parted ways for Musa alayhi salam when he needed it most. But look at the beginning of his life, the beginning of his youth. He made a promise to Allah not to use his strength in the disobedience of Allah. He made a promise to Allah not to use his strength to help those who are criminals. He made a promise to Allah not to oppress others. And similarly, in our day-to-day lives, we are looking for the help of Allah. We are looking for the fruits of our ibadah and our worship. Start off by rectifying yourself. Whatever resources Allah Jalla wa'ala has given you, whatever goodness He's given you, whatever bounties He's bestowed upon you, use them in a way that pleases Allah. Don't use your strength, your wealth, your free time, your skill in a way that displeases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What does Musa alayhi salam do after that? A man comes and tells him, oh Musa, the people are looking for you. So, I am a well-wisher of yours. You should flee this place or this community. Allah says, وَلَمَّا تَوَجَّهَ تِلْقَاءَ مَدْيَنْ قَالَ عَسَى رَبِّي أَنْ يَهْدِيَنِي سَوَاءَ السَّبِيلِ. Point number two. Musa alayhi salam, he faces towards Madian and he says, indeed, or he makes a dua, that Allah will guide me to the correct path. He'll guide me towards the correct way. Look at how, even before prophethood, he had a relationship with Allah. He had put his trust in Allah. And similarly, don't wait for calamity to befall you. Don't wait for you to get into trouble so that you turn to dua. Even when things are going well, make sure you maintain that relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ask Allah. Eventually, Musa alayhi salam reaches Madian. Allah says, he's fled for his life, he's got nothing, and he comes to a place where the people are feeding or getting water for their animals. Allah says, وَلَمَّا وَرَدَ مَاءَ مَدْيَنْ وَجَدَ عَلَيْهِ أُمَّةً مِّنَ النَّاسِ يَسْقُونَ. He comes to a place where there's the water for the people of Madian, and he finds everybody getting water for their animals. However, there's two young girls waiting on the side. And Musa alayhi salam asks them, why are you waiting? And they said, we wait for the men to finish. Let them finish, then we will go with our animals. What does Musa alayhi salam do? Imagine, he's a stranger in that land. Allah says, فَسَقَى لَهُمَا. Musa alayhi salam takes the animals and makes them drink. And this is point number three, my beloved brothers and sisters in Islam. If you want to taste the power of worship, be somebody who is helpful to others, your community members, the people who you know as well as the strangers. Musa alayhi salam didn't know who these people were. There was no relationship. He didn't have an ulterior motive. He didn't want anything from them. And imagine, he's a stranger in the land, he's got nothing. But Allah says, he still went to do a good deed. He went to help these people. At times you may be driving a new town, a new community, or as you're traveling abroad and somebody needs help, it may only take you a few moments, but be that Muslim who helps others. We all know the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, where he says that Allah helps the servant. Allah helps his servant as long as his servant is in the service of others. As long as you help others, Allah will help you. As long as you help others, you will see the power of your worship, the power of your ibadah. Eventually, the two girls go back home and they tell their father what happened, what occurred. So the father calls for Musa alayhi salam. Eventually, they have an agreement. He wants to get one of his daughters married to Musa alayhi salam, and he tells Musa alayhi salam to remain with him for 10 years, come help, you live with us, we'll get you married, etc. Notice how Allah Jalla wa'ala says that Musa alayhi salam completed this period of time. What's the message for us? You have an agreement with somebody else, whether it's a business agreement or some other agreement where you have certain responsibilities, certain duties as well as them. Uphold your side of the agreement. Musa alayhi salam, he agreed and then he upheld that agreement, that period of time. We speak about how the sea parted ways, but look at all the good deeds he had before this. Look at how he was a refined individual, one of the best of the Anbiya alayhi salatu was salam, one of the best people to have ever walked the face of the earth. And this is before Nubuwwah. Allah is telling you that when he gave his word, he stuck with it. He stuck with his side of the agreement. So be that person and you'll find bi-idhnillah this power or this help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Eventually we all know Musa alayhi salam receives prophethood and Allah jalla wa ala sends him to Fir'aun. In Surah Al-Kahf, towards the end, Allah Jalla wa Ala makes mention again of Musa alayhi salam. If you ponder over the Quran and realize, you'll see Musa alayhi salam, his story is mentioned the most in the Quran. And we have the most detail of anybody, from his upbringing to his prophethood to him with his family, etc. Why? Because his story is important. His story is extremely important. Towards the end of Surah Al-Kahf, Allah Jalla wa Ala says, Musa alayhi salam went on a journey to seek knowledge. Why did he go on this journey? Because one day as he was amongst his people, somebody asked him a question. They said, oh Musa, who is the most knowledgeable? So without thinking much, he said, I am the most knowledgeable. So Allah Jalla wa Ala reprimanded him. And he said, oh Musa, there is a servant of ours who has been given certain knowledge that even you don't have. Imagine if you are an expert in your field and you're amongst a group of people and somebody asks a question or says, who has the most knowledge? And immediately you say, I have. And then someone says, no, it's not you. What's the normal human reaction that a person would have in today's time? No, he knows nothing. A Nabi of Allah, what does he do? He's humble. Look at his humbleness and his humility. He asks Allah, oh Allah, show me where the servant of yours is so I can go and learn from him. And similarly, you want to benefit from your ibadah. You want to see the power of worship. You need to be humble. You need to be a person who, for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, does not oppress others. That's why when speaking about Jannah, Allah says, تِلْكَ الدَّارُ الْآخِرَةُ نَجْعَلُهَا لِلَّذِينَ لَا يُرِيدُونَ عُلُوًّا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا فَسَادًا. This Jannah that we have made and prepared for the people, it's for the people who have certain qualities. Two of these qualities, they don't want to be higher than others in the land, i.e. not from a perspective of arrogance. And they don't want to oppress others. A Nabi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is told that somebody knows more than you. He's humble enough to say, "Oh Allah, show me where the servant of yours is so I can benefit from him." Musa alayhi salam with his brother. When Allah gives him prophethood, what does he do? He calls out to Allah and he says, "Oh Allah, wa akhi Harun huwa afsahu minni lisana fa arsilhu ma'iya rid'an yusaddiquni." He also wants goodness for his family members. He says, "Oh Allah, my brother Harun, he is more eloquent than me. He can speak better than me. So send him with me so we can go with your message to the Pharaoh." What's the lesson for me and you? Acknowledge the strengths of those who are around you. Some of the scholars mention, if there was a brother who did his sibling a great favor, the greatest of favors, it was Musa alayhi salam for his brother, because he interceded to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he make Harun a prophet of Allah. My beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, I encourage you to go through the story of Musa alayhi salam. Ask yourself, Allah granted him victory. Allah caused the sea to part ways when he needed it most. Why? What were some of the reasons? And you go through his life and you see Musa alayhi salam was an upright human being. Musa alayhi salam was a Nabi of Allah. Musa alayhi salam was an honest person. And the lesson is for us. Sometimes a person says, "I perform my salah, I make my dua, I try my best. However, I don't see any benefit in my ibadah, in my acts of worship." Ask yourself, besides paying lip service in dua, and besides just going through the motions in salah, have I truly rectified my heart? Have I truly put my life onto the straight path or not? Have I changed for the better as a Muslim? If you're able to answer that question, bi-ithnillah, you'll able to find the power of worship. Answer it correctly and you'll find the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine a young boy, Abdullah ibn Abbas, radiallahu anhuma. It's mentioned that when the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away, Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma was only about 12 or 13 years old. So while he was still young, one day the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got hold of him and he said, "Ya ghulam," he says, "Oh young boy, inni u'allimuka kalimat," let me teach you a few good words. Then he gives him advice. Imagine he's a youngster and he says, "Ihfadhi Allah yahfadhk," protect the covenant that is between you and Allah will protect you. Then he says, "Ihfadhi Allah tajidhu tujahak or tajidhu amamak." When you protect this covenant between you and Allah, you'll find Allah in front of you. You'll find the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala coming. You'll find that Allah jalla wa ala will make your life easy. Then he gives him an important piece of advice that every single one of us needs, especially in the modern world we live in. He says, "Ta'arraf ila Allah fi ar-raha ya'rifka fi ash-shiddah." Know who is Allah. Be mindful of Allah, especially in times of ease. And rest assured that when your difficulty comes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help you. You know, when a person goes through difficulty and hardship, it's human nature to turn back to Allah. It's a good thing. It's not bad. But the minute this affliction or this difficulty is removed, you find a person forgets who Allah is. Don't be that person. In many verses of the Quran, Allah tells us that that's the human, his nature is like that. When any calamity and hardship befalls him, he wants to remember Allah. And when goodness befalls him, he forgets who Allah is. Some go a step further to say, "This is only because of my intelligence. This is only because of me and me alone." Don't be that person who forgets Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So much so When you look in Surah Saba, the people of Saba, Allah Jalla wa'ala says that we gave them goodness and we gave them so many bounties. Eventually, they were ungrateful, so Allah destroyed them. Interestingly enough, at the end of their story in Surah Saba, Allah says, إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِكُلِّ صَبَّارٍ شَكُورٍ. In their story are signs, there are lessons for those who are patient and those who are grateful. Now ponder and reflect. Why do you think Allah said that in their story are signs for those who are patient, but He's telling you that they had bliss and bounty? Because when you have goodness in your life, when you've got a lot of wealth, when you've got good health, you need to be patient also. Some people get bored. You know, the minute that they've got a lot of wealth, they say, let's go and try this haram and that haram activity and another haram activity. Why? Out of boredom. Out of boredom. Don't be that person. You need to be patient when you're going through difficulty and when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted you goodness. So my beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma, he says, ta'arraf ila Allah fi al-rakha, ya'rifka fi al-shidda. Know who Allah is. Worship Allah, especially in times of ease, and Allah will remember you in times of difficulty. Then he ends off the hadith by saying, oh Abdullah ibn Abbas, you should know that if the whole world, if everybody had to gather in order to benefit you in any way, they will be unable to benefit you in any way unless Allah decrees, unless Allah wishes. And if they all gather to harm you in any way, they will be unable to harm you except if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wishes. And similarly, in the verses of the Quran, Allah says, وَإِن يَمْسَسْكَ اللَّهُ بِضُرٍ فَلَا كَاشِفَ لَهُ إِلَّا هُ. Some difficulty or affliction befalls you, nobody can remove it except Allah. And some goodness comes your way, nobody can take it away from you except if Allah wishes. My beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, know who Allah is. If you want to truly benefit from the power of your ibadah, you should know the one who made this ibadah compulsory upon you. Get to know Allah by His great names and His great attributes. You know, when Allah tells you that He is Ar-Rahman, He is the most merciful, take a moment to ponder over that name. You read it in Surah Al-Fatiha several times a day. Second verse, and some mention, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is the first verse of Surah Al-Fatiha. You acknowledge that your Lord is the most merciful. Imagine, the most merciful. Call out to Him. Of course He knows your problems. Do you think He wants to put you through difficulty and hardship? But at times the issue we have is we don't have conviction. And we don't know who Allah is. You know, when Allah tells you that He is Ala kulli shay'in qadir, He's able to do all things. He has the power and the might. He is omnipotent. When you read this verse, when you understand the power of Allah, then you know that the one who you are worshipping, you think your ibadah will go to waste. You think when you call out to Him and He promised, He said, Ud'uni astajib lakum, call out to Me and I will respond to your dua. You think He'll waste your dua? So have good thoughts of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Get to know Allah and be close to the Quran, the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you'll find, bi-ithnillah, you will taste the sweetness of ibadah, you taste the sweetness of worship, and you'll benefit from your ibadah in your deen as well as in your dunya and in the hereafter where you need your good deeds the most. Today I just want to touch on one powerful act of worship. If a person carries it out, bi-ithnillah, he will be successful in his deen, he will benefit in his dunya, and in the akhirah, bi-ithnillah, he will be forgiven, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will enter him or her into Jannah. To understand this act of worship, we go back to Surah Al-Baqarah. Allah Jalla wa'ala, at the beginning, He mentions how He created humankind. So imagine, there was a time where there were no humans in existence. Imagine. Then Allah Jalla wa Ala tells the angels that He wanted to create human beings. Allah tells the angels, and the angels respond. They say, "Oh Allah, why do you want to create those people who will cause corruption in the earth? They will cause problems, they will kill, etc." And Allah tells them that I know that which you don't know. He eventually creates Adam alayhi salam. Now think of the honor, the prestige, the privilege. Adam alayhi salam is the first human being. Allah honored him. And then the angels are asked a question. They asked by Allah to name certain things, and they don't know the answer. They don't know the answer. And Allah tells Adam alayhi salam, after teaching him the names, He says, "Oh Adam, inform them about the names of these things." So imagine, Adam alayhi salam, in the company of the malaika, Allah jalla wa ala tests them. Imagine there's a question here I had to ask, and nobody knows the answer. And one person from the back had to know the answer, and they come up and they get a prize. What privilege is that? A person is honored. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honors Adam alayhi salam by teaching him the names. Adam alayhi salam answers correctly. Allah tells the angels to prostrate to Adam alayhi salam, to honor him, show your respect. And everybody prostrates, all the malaika, all the angels prostrate to Adam alayhi salam, except who? Except Iblis. Iblis didn't prostrate to Adam alayhi salam. Eventually Allah tells Adam, He says, "For you and your wife, you live here in Jannah. You can do as you please, but there's only one tree that you shouldn't go next to. Don't even get close to it. And as for this shaitan, Iblis, you should know that he is your clear enemy." Adam alayhi salam starts off on the right track. Allah has warned him. Allah has honored him. Allah has told him what to do and what not to do. Eventually, our father Adam alayhi salam, he makes a mistake, because Iblis carries on pursuing him, whispering to him, "You know what, do this, eat from the tree, eat from the tree." Eventually he eats from the tree, and Allah jalla wa ala tells Adam alayhi salam and his wife, "Alam anhakuma an tilkuma ash-shajara? Did I not prevent you from eating from the tree? Wa aqul lakuma inna ash-shaytana lakuma aduwwun mubin." And I told you, this shaitan, he is your clear enemy. What do Adam and Hawa alayhim as-salam say? Immediately they know they've made a mistake. They say, "Qala rabbana zalamna anfusana." Our Lord, we have oppressed ourselves. My beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, this is the act of worship I want to touch on today. Turning back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Being somebody who makes istighfar, even if Allah has given you so much and you had to make that mistake, be like our father Adam alayhi salam, who immediately turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This tawbah is powerful. This tawbah, bi-idhnillah, puts your life back on track. From Allah's mercy, He taught us, and He informs us in many different verses, when you make a mistake, turn back to Allah and your bad deeds will be wiped away. They will be forgiven, bi-idhnillah. So much so, in some verses Allah says, فَأُولَٰئِكَ يُبَدِّلُ اللَّهُ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ حَسَنَاتٍ. There's some people who the evil deeds will be changed into good deeds. What's that? It shows you that this tawbah and repentance and turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is powerful. In fact, from the mercy of Allah, He taught our father Adam alayhi salam the actual tawbah, the words. Allah says, فَتَلَقَّى آدَمُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ. Allah taught him how to make the tawbah, and Allah accepted that repentance and that tawbah. Not only that, when you look at some of the other prophets and some of the other pious worshippers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you find that Allah mentions the benefit of this istighfar, seeking Allah's forgiveness, turning to Him in repentance. He mentions that there are worldly benefits also. Nuh alayhi salam, he called his people for
1,000 years except 50, i.e. 950 years. Imagine, for us, that's like 10 lifetimes. Nuh alayhi salam is just calling the people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And his people, they mock him, they make fun of him, they carry on troubling him. And these very people, he tells them, he says, "Oh Allah, I told them, فَقُلْتُ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ." Just turn to Allah, seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How will you benefit? You should know, إِنَّهُ كَانَ غَفَّارًا. Allah is the one who forgives sin. He loves to forgive. Not only that, يُرْسِلِ السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِدْرَارًا. These are the worldly benefits of this act of worship. The worldly benefits. Number one, he will send down the rain. Now, ponder and reflect. In those days, there was no modern technology. Today, mashallah, you go home and you open the tap when you need water. In those days, people had to go to the lakes and the rivers, or when it rained during the season, they had to save the water. So much so, if you look through the maps and you had to look at some of the settlements which are further away from the city, what you'll notice is all the houses generally are along the river. Because what? Water is the source of life. Allah has made it such. So Nuh alayhi salam is telling his people, when you make this istighfar, Allah will grant you water from the skies, i.e. your living condition will improve. It will become easy for you. Not only that, وَيُمْدِدْكُمْ بِأَمْوَالٍ وَبَنِينَ. Allah will grant you wealth and he'll grant you children. وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ أَنْهَارًا. He'll grant you gardens, etc. What's that? That's some of the worldly benefits from istighfar. It shows you the power of turning back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So much so, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when describing some of the pious worshippers of his, he makes mention of some of their good deeds. He says, telling us that Jannah is very vast and the people should hasten towards Jannah. Then he mentions some of the qualities of the people of Jannah. What are these qualities? الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ فِي السَّرَّاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ. Number one, those who they spend for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in times of ease and in time of difficulty. الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ فِي السَّرَّاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ وَالْكَاظِمِينَ الْغَيْظِ. They hold in their anger. وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ. They forgive the people. And this word here, وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ, remember it because I'm going to come back to it. وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ. What are all these? These are all good deeds. Allah says, وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. He loves the good doers. What does he say after that? Imagine, the quality or some of the qualities of the people of Jannah. Do they sin? Do they make a mistake? Allah says, yes. وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا فَعَلُوا فَاحِشَةً أَوْ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ ذَكَرُوا اللَّهِ. These very people, if they had to make a mistake and they had to oppress themselves, what's the first thing they do? They remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَاسْتَغْفَرُوا لِذُنُوبِهِمْ. They seek Allah's forgiveness because they know وَمَنْ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Nobody can forgive sin except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what's their condition when they make tawbah? Allah says, وَلَمْ يُصِرُّوا عَلَى مَا فَعَلُوا وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. They don't carry on committing the sin whilst they are aware and they are mindful. I don't think that there's any person who calls themselves a true believer and they sin on purpose. Think about it. Every time you've made a mistake or you've fallen into sin, you were perhaps unmindful at the time. You forgot. But every believer has that conscience. How many of us, you know that when you've committed a sin, after a while you feel terrible, you feel bad, you turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Here Allah is telling you, even the pious worshippers of Allah, those who are promised Jannah, those who will be entered into Jannah, they make mistakes. But the power of this istighfar, this tawbah, this turning back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, puts them back on track. And Allah says, أُولَٰئِكَ جَزَاؤُهُمْ مَغْفِرَةٌ مِّن رَبِّهِمْ وَجَنَّاتٍ. These people, their reward is Allah will forgive them and He will enter them into Jannah. May Allah enter us all into Jannah. Not only that, when it comes to turning back to Allah, istighfar as well as tawbah, you find that those who know who Allah is, they truly understand the power of Allah, His names, His mercy. Not only do they stop at tawbah, they ask for more. Look at Sulaiman alayhi salam. In Surah Sad, Allah says, وَلَقَدْ فَتَنَّا سُلَيْمَانَ. We tested Sulaiman alayhi salam. We threw on his throne a body. The scholars of tafsir, they mention a lot when it comes to this story. You can go back to the books of tafsir and see what's exactly mentioned. What we know is it was a test for Sulaiman alayhi salam. Immediately he realizes that he's made a mistake. So he turns to Allah. What does he say? He says, قَالَ رَبِّ اغْفِرْ لِي. O Allah, forgive my sin. He doesn't stop there. He knows who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. He knows Allah is kind. He says, وَهَبْ لِي مُلْكًا لَا يَنْبَغِي لِأَحَدٍ مِّن بَعْدِي. Not only should you forgive me, O Allah, grant me kingdom that nobody will have after me. Imagine, that's like if somebody made a mistake, you committed a sin, and after you say, O Allah, forgive me, I'm remorseful, I regret, and O Allah, grant me so much wealth, and grant me, etc. Sulaiman alayhi salam knows the kindness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he knows the power of turning to Allah. So my beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, if there's one message you can take away from my talk today, we all make mistakes. But be from those who pick themselves up by turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This tawbah, this istighfar is powerful. You benefit, as we mentioned, you benefit in your deen as well as in your worldly life. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised forgiveness and jannah for those who constantly engage in istighfar. So much so he says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ التَّوَّابِينَ. Allah jalla wa ala is the one who loves those who constantly turn back to Him. And as you seek Allah's forgiveness, remember that we live in communities and societies where we have to interact with others. And at times, they may wrong us, and at times, we may wrong them. We're not talking about a person who feels or a person who knows that they've been wronged or oppressed and they say that, you know what, I want to hold on to my right. I don't want to forgive. You're able to do that. But better than that is if you forgive. Notice the verse we mentioned earlier. Allah says, praising the people of Jannah, وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ. They forgive the people. So as you hear and you seek the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, know that when somebody has wronged you and they sincerely come, they're asking you for forgiveness, find it in your heart to forgive them. You find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open your doors bi-ithnillah. Look at Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu. He was the best person to have lived after the Anbiya alayhim as-salatu was-salam. Imagine, the best. And there comes a time where his daughter Aisha radiyallahu anha is accused of committing a sin that she didn't commit. And one of the people peddling the rumors is a relative of his. And this relative, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu, used to help him financially. And when Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu hears about it, he says, I will never help this person again. What does Allah say? Allah says, وَلَا يَأْتَلِ أُولُو الْفَضْلِ مِنْكُمْ وَالسَّعَةِ أَنْ يُؤْتُوا أُولِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْمَسَاكِينَ وَالْمُهَاجِرِينَ. Until the end of the ayah, Allah says, it's not befitting. It's not befitting for a believer who Allah has given wealth to decide not to help their close relatives, those who are in need, etc. Then Allah says, وَلْيَعْفُوا وَلْيَصْفَحُوا. Try to forgive and reconcile between one another. And then he mentions, أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ أَن يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. Do you not love that Allah forgives your sin? I.e., in the same way we are all seeking the forgiveness of Allah, we seek the mercy of Allah. Allah is saying that when people who are in need, when people are remorseful and regretful, and they ask for forgiveness, forgive them so that you attain the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, there are many acts of worship mentioned in the Quran. As I mentioned at the beginning, when you define ibadah, correctly, you find that it's unlimited what can come under this category from what you think in your heart, what you intend, what you say, what you do. The acts of worship are many. It's impossible for a Muslim to carry out every act of worship. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made certain acts of worship easy for you. Be from those who carry out these acts of worship and know that bi-idhnillah you will benefit. What's interesting is before I came, I was thinking about it. And I looked over the different acts of worship mentioned in the Quran. So you find this salah, there's dua, other acts of worship. And you find that how many times we've read of people from the past, anbiya, messengers of Allah, as well as pious people, who made dua, and their dua was accepted. And then you find there are those who say, we carry on making dua, however, we don't feel that our dua is accepted. What's the difference? There's a few differences or a few points to consider, but the most important you will find is these people knew who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was. They knew His great names, His great attributes. They had a relationship with Allah. And I want to touch on one story in the Quran that drives this point home. We all know in Surah Al-Imran, the story of Maryam alayha salam is mentioned. Allah jalla wa ala mentions that after she was born, she was under the care of Zakariya alayhi salam, who was also a prophet of Allah. Allah says, وَكَفَّلَهَا Zakariya. Then Allah makes mention of something very interesting. Maryam alayha salam is a young girl. Zakariya alayhi salam is much older. And Allah says, كُلَّمَا دَخَلَ عَلَيْهَا زَكَرِيَّ الْمِحْرَابِ وَجَدَ عِنْدَهَا رِزْقًا. Every time Zakariya alayhi salam entered the mihrab, his place of worship, obviously, Maryam alayha salam is there. She's still young. He finds with her some sustenance. Some of the scholars mention she had some fruit. Okay? And as you know, the seasons of the year differ. So the fruit in summer is different to the fruit in winter. Some of the scholars mention that in the summertime, she had fruit which would only come out in winter. And in the wintertime, she had fruit which would only come out in summer. So Zakariya alayhi salam is amazed. And he asks her, where is this from, O Maryam? And she says, or he says, قَالَ يَا مَرْيَمُ أَنَّا لَكِ هَذَا. O Maryam, this fruit you've got, where is it from? And she says, قَالَتْ هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ. It's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then she says something very interesting. She says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَرْزُقُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. Allah sustains, He grants sustenance to whomsoever He wishes, however He wishes, without any limit. Without any limit. Now, Zakariya alayhi salam was old. He didn't have children. And Allah says, at that moment, هُنَالِكَ دَعَى زَكَرِيَّا رَبَّهُ. At that moment, Zakariya alayhi salam knows that this girl who's got fruit in a season that it's not supposed to be present in, she's got this fruit from Allah. So surely Allah can grant me children even if I may have reached old age. What's the act of worship he engages in after that? It's dua. But more importantly, look at how he knows the power of Allah. He has full trust in Allah. He doesn't lose hope in the mercy of Allah and what Allah can give him. So Allah Jalla wa Ala says, هُنَالِكَ دَعَى زَكَرِيَّا رَبَّهُ. At that point, Zakariya alayhi salam, he makes dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he asks for pious offspring. قَالَ رَبِّ هَبْلِي مِنْ لَدُنْكَ ذُرِّيَّةً طَيِّبَةً. Oh Allah, grant me pure offspring. إِنَّكَ سَمِيعُ الدُّعَاء. You are the one who hears my dua. How many of us, we have, or we go through difficulty in life, and we make dua. Dua in and of itself is a great act of worship. This dua is powerful. And this dua should actually remind us how powerful Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. Allah has the best of names, the best of attributes. Allah told you, He says, this dua is a powerful act of worship. When my worshippers ask about me, فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ, I am close to them. In another verse, Allah says, وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمُ ادْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ. Imagine, He's telling you, the one who created you, the one who is the most merciful, the one who is الرزاق, the one who owns sustenance, whatever problems you have, He's able to help you through your problems. He says, call out to me, أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ, I will respond to your dua. So don't lose hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at this Nabi of Allah. Why do you think Allah tells us the story? So that we can relate. You think something is impossible. The act of worship, the ibadah is powerful, and more powerful is the Lord you worship, Allah, the one and only. He is one and He is most powerful. So Zakariya alayhi salam makes dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he says, oh Allah, you hear my dua. Eventually, Allah says, we send glad tidings to him. فَنَادَتْهُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ وَهُوَ قَائِمٌ يُصَلِّي فِي الْمِحْرَابِ. The angels came to him with glad tidings of a son. What I want you to notice is, Allah mentions, when this glad tidings came, where was Zakariya alayhi salam? He was in the mihrab, the place of worship. And similarly, sometimes we make dua. We call out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How do you expect Allah to answer your dua if you haven't made a change or you haven't gone towards Him? The bad habits you had in your life, have you tried to leave them altogether? Have you made some sort of tawbah? Or are you just paying lip service? A prophet of Allah whose dua is accepted, he's still in a place of worship. He's still asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Musa alayhi salam, after Allah told him, oh Musa, your dua is accepted, yours and your brothers, he said, fastaqima, remain steadfast, because you will see the fruits of this dua, i.e. the destruction of the Pharaoh. It's going to come, it's not immediate. But the dua has been accepted. So when you make dua, remember that Allah will not waste your dua. Zakariya alayhi salam gets this glad tiding. And he's told that he will be given a son, whose name will be Yahya alayhi salam, also a prophet of Allah. Interestingly enough, Zakariya alayhi salam, obviously he's a prophet of Allah, he's convinced. But he asks Allah for a sign. I want you to hear what Allah says and then ask yourself, why did Allah give him this sign? So Zakariya alayhi salam says, قَالَ رَبِّ جَعَلِّي آيَةً. Oh my Lord, give me a sign because my wife is old. How is this possible? Give me a sign. So Allah says, قَالَ آيَتُكَ أَلَّا تُكَلِّمَ النَّاسَ ثَلَاثَةَ أَيَّامٍ إِلَّا رَمْزًا. Your sign is that you will be unable to speak to the people. You'll be unable to converse with them for 3 days. The only way you'll be able to communicate is through some sort of sign language. That's the sign that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him. Anybody knows what some of the scholars have mentioned when it comes to the reason why this sign was given? There's some beautiful explanations mentioned by the scholars. Anybody knows before I give you the answer? Some of the scholars mentioned that Zakariya alayhi salam, he was able to speak the whole time. During these 3 days where he was unable to speak, his tongue was still present. Allah is trying to show him that the means for you to speak, i.e. the tongue, is still there. However, if Allah does not permit the means, if Allah does not allow you to use the means in order to attain a result, it won't happen. Let everything be put in place. If Allah has not decreed, it won't happen. So you have your tongue, but there'll come a time where you unable to speak. And similarly, the opposite is true. At times, the means in front of you, the means in front of you are not present. In this story, Zakaria alayhi salam is old. His wife is old and barren. Apparently to us, it's impossible for her to give birth. But Allah shows him the power of Allah. The apparent means may not be there, but if we decree that you will have a child, it will happen. And this should increase your iman as a believer. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can grant you through the means which seem apparent, and Allah can also give you, even if the means do not seem apparent. This is what we take from the stories of the Anbiya alayhim as-salatu was-salam. These stories take us back to strengthening our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After he tells Zakaria alayhi salam, you'll be unable to speak for 3 days, he tells him, وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ كَثِيرًا. Imagine he's unable to speak, and Allah says, during this period of time, engage in a lot of dhikr. Remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in abundance. Some of the scholars mention, if there was a person who could have been excused from dhikr, the remembrance of Allah, it would have been Zakaria alayhi salam, because he was unable to speak. So as you try to improve, and as you make dua and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, make sure your acts of worship are in order. Make sure your life is in order. Be somebody of dhikr. Be somebody who remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in abundance. Allah then tells him, وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ كَثِيرًا وَسَبِّحْ بِالْعَشِيِّ وَالْإِبْكَارِ. In another verse he says, and remind your people to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you ponder over the stories mentioned in the Quran, the stories of the Anbiya alayhim as-salatu was-salam, the stories of the pious people, you'll find that they are acts of worship, and no doubt a person who engages in these acts of worship, they benefit in this world, they benefit in terms of their deen, their dunya, and their akhirah. But more importantly, it's for a person to develop a relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to understand that Allah is the one and only, and He is in charge. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions in a hadith recorded in Sahih al-Bukhari, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us a story of 3 people who came from the previous nations. What I want you to notice in the story is, look at the different acts of worship they carried out, okay? And look at their sincerity. Look at how they call out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this shows you that this ibadah you carry out is powerful and you benefit. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, there were 3 people from the previous generations. One day they went out and there was a storm. You know, like how when you're driving here in the UK and all of a sudden the weather changes. So similarly, they were out and the weather changed, so they went into a cave. Whilst they were in the cave, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, a big boulder, a big rock came and it fell in front of the entrance. They could not escape. They couldn't come out. And what happens? They all realize that it's only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who can help us. We can't do anything for ourselves. So they start to make dua. And notice how this dua, my beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, is powerful. This dua is powerful. You are calling out to Allah, the one who is the omnipotent. He is able to change your condition. All these stories are to give us hope, to know that the one who we call out to, who is Allah, He is able to change your condition. So the first one he calls out and he says, oh Allah, I had parents who were elderly and I made it my mission, or it was my habit, that whenever I got some milk, I used to milk the animals, I would make sure that they drink first. I would make sure that they drink first. One day when I came with the milk, they were asleep. I didn't want to wake them up. I didn't want to disturb them. And in the same breath, I didn't want anybody to drink before them. So I waited. I waited. I waited until They got up and they drank first. What was his good deed? He was good to his parents. He was good to his parents. Also, notice how the deed, his good deed, was carried out in secret. There was an element of sincerity. At times, we find that people carry out deeds which seem, apparently, they seem major. However, the lack of sincerity in the heart may diminish the reward, and at times it may negate or cancel the reward altogether. And at times you find those who carry out acts of worship which seem to be very small in nature, but because of the sincerity in the heart, Allah Jalla wa'ala multiplies the reward of these deeds. In a verse in the Quran, Allah says, He gives you the example of those who spend in the path of Allah. He says, مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ كَمَثَلِ حَبَّهِ. Allah says, those who spend for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the example given in terms of their reward, He says, it's like one grain. And this one grain, when you plant it in the ground, it gives you 7 ears of corn, and each ear has 100 grains. So what's the multiplication? 700-fold. Allah says, you give the ground, which is the creation of Allah, you give it one, it gives you back 700 and more. So what about the reward of Allah? This makhluk, this thing which is created by Allah, gives you back so much. What about when you worship Allah, when you do good deeds, especially in secret? After that, Allah says, وَاللَّهُ يُضَاعِفُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. Allah multiplies the reward more than 700-fold for whomsoever He wishes. Some of the scholars of tafsir mention at this verse, they say this is according to a person's sincerity. Be sincere. And have those acts of worship that you carry out in private that nobody else knows about. One of the great scholars of the past, Abdullah ibn al-Mubarak, rahimahullah, he says that at times a person carries out an act of worship, rubba amalin, saghirin, it's small, however it's magnified due to the intention. And at times a person carries out a major deed, wa rubba amalin kabirin, tusaghiruhu niyyah. The intention is minimized, or the intention minimizes the reward. So getting back to the story, the first person, he makes a dua. He says, oh Allah, I was good to my parents. And if you know that I did this act of worship for your sake, sincerely for you, then help us in the affliction we are in. And the boulder moved a little bit. It moved a little bit, but they were unable to come out. So the second person, he makes dua. He says, oh Allah, I had a relative of mine. She was a beautiful woman. I wanted to commit zina with her. I wanted to commit sin with her. She refused and refused, and I carried on pursuing her. Eventually, there came a time where she needed the money. So I gave her the money on condition that we commit the sin. He says, eventually, we were about to commit the sin. And she told me, Ya Abdullah, O servant of Allah, fear Allah, and you should know that this deed, or he says, the seal should not be broken except through that which is lawful. And he says, oh Allah, at that point, I left the sin. I left the sin, and I left whatever wealth I had given her. And then he says, oh Allah, if I did this deed for your sake, sincerely for you, help us in the affliction we are in. And the boulder moved a little bit more, but they were unable to come out. Now imagine the third person who's there. He says, oh Allah, I had people who were working for me, and I used to pay them their wages. However, there was this one person who left his wage with me. In some of the narrations of the hadith, it's mentioned a few grains of rice. So he says, I took these few grains and I grew them. In our terms, somebody gives you some wealth and you invested it. He says, I started growing it. Eventually the crops They multiplied. There was more than enough. I bought livestock. I bought camels. I bought sheep, etc. Eventually, he came to me years later. He came to me years later. And he said, O servant of Allah, give me what is mine. What is due to me, give it to me. And he says, I told him, all the wealth that you see in this valley between the two mountains, it's all yours. And the person was shocked. He says, are you joking with me? And he says, I'm not joking with you. This is all your wealth. Take it. And then this man says, oh Allah, he took everything. Imagine, it started off with a little bit. And then it multiplied. And when the person eventually came, he took everything. Then he says, oh Allah, if I did this act of worship sincerely for your sake, please help us in the affliction we are in. And the boulder moved and they were able to come out. Now ponder over the lessons we derive from the story. The first person, obedient to his parents, an act of worship. The second person, he left sin for the sake of Allah. The third person, he was honest when it came to his transactions. So your ibadah is not limited to salah. It's not limited to fasting. Yes, these are important acts of worship. But in your day-to-day lives, the fact that you came here, the fact that you have children or you have parents or you go to school, where whatever it may be, you are able to be engaged in an act of worship. All you need is the correct intention and to be doing the correct thing because it's powerful. You benefit in this world. You become closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, I want you all to ponder and reflect. Imagine you were in that cave and the first person made his dua and the boulder moved a little bit. The second person made their dua and the boulder moved a little bit more. And imagine you were the third person. Imagine. Do you have a deed with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, secret good deed that you know you carried out sincerely for his sake, that you would have been able to make dua at that particular time and the boulder would have moved? Answer that question. And if you go through, you jog your memory and you find that there is no deed that you can recall, then if there's one message I can give you today, and please take it away, if there's only this one point, from today on, make sure you have a secret act of worship between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only, that nobody else knows about. Why? Number one, it's closer to sincerity. Number two, you know that you did it for the sake of Allah alone. And number three, you will most definitely need that good deed. You will need the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this world as well as in the next. Imagine you come on the day of judgment and a person obviously forgetting the good they did, the bad they did, etc. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has a record of your whole life, every single thing you did, the time where you most in need of this act of worship, and it's taken out and presented to you, and it's told to you that on such and such a day, you did this good deed for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it's the reason for you to be entered into Jannah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enter us all in the highest part of Jannah. These good deeds, as I told you, are many. Try to have those which are carried out in secret. At least one. At least one. It's mentioned that the great grandson of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he was in Medina, the poor people, they found that every morning when they woke up, they would find some food, some bread at their doors. They didn't know who was doing this good deed or this charitable act. Eventually, when he passed away, the people of Medina, the poor people of Medina, they found that there was no more food. And when they washed the body, they found that on his back there were marks. What were the marks? He used to carry the heavy sacks of food in order to give the poor people. It was a secret good deed between him and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, our religion is beautiful. The religion of Islam is beautiful. And as I told you, as I mentioned, every single moment in your life can be an act of worship. Even when you're thinking, the thoughts you have, make sure they are good thoughts. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam tells us in a hadith, وَمَنْ هَمَّ بِحَسَنَةٍ فَلَمْ يَعْمَلْهَا. Whoever intends to do a good deed, imagine he hasn't done it. وَمَنْ هَمَّ بِحَسَنَةٍ فَلَمْ يَعْمَلْهَا كَتَبَهَا اللَّهُ عِنْدَهُ حَسَنَةً كَامِلَةً. A person wants to do a good deed, he doesn't do the good deed, Allah still gives him a full reward. Imagine the reward of the person who carries out the deed. Imagine the reward of the person who actually carries out that act of worship. With those few words, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all goodness. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from those who taste the sweetness of iman. To make us from those who are the people of the Quran, and may He accept our acts of worship. Ameen. May He gather us in the highest part of Jannah. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.